Hello, and welcome to Transistor 3.1. I am Non-Euclidean Cat.
And my name is Kaz. Things are happening so quickly.
All right, Kaz, how much do you know about Transistor?
Actually, nothing. I have never seen this game played, and suddenly there's all this stuff on the screen and many words. I'm just kind of...
All right. So, I asked you, completely sight unseen, to devise me a loadout out of all of these choices.
Correct.
And then I would play through it up until the second boss, and it was an interesting layout you gave me. Actually, surprisingly effective.
Oh, no kidding. I was choosing it based on how it sounded. You gave me letters?
Yes.
And I told you... Baba kill hike no.
Yes, and I had to cheat on that a little bit because of rules.
Okay. Alright, well, so that's fine.
You might have seen on the left there was a big bar that was 32 bits of memory, and every function costs some number of bits between 1 and 4. And you managed to give me a lot of the most expensive functions.
Oh, okay.
So I couldn't fill up all of the slots.
Well, also, that's fine. So long as you're not, like, you didn't, like, cheat code yourself into having too much power or anything.
No. Heads
up. Wait, humidity? Whoa, porch? Oh, man.
What? Okay. Yes, so we are in Cloud Bank, where everything is run by computers. And there are statistics on everything.
No, I like statistics.
This is our first fight. We are fighting zoners. Their trick is that they mess with your ability to see things.
I'm gonna need to take a few steps back, if you don't mind.
Alright.
I presume that you were the sword lady.
Yes, Muse.
Okay. Sure. And that your goal involves defeating monsters.
Yes.
Okay, that's another step. And that this sword helps you defeat monsters somehow.
Yes.
From there, I'm a little lost.
All right, so the sword is the Transistor. He is our boyfriend.
All right.
And the Transistor has access, when fully upgraded, to 16 different functions, two instances of each, but they haven't stopped that us. We can equip.
Combat techniques.
We go around and kill monsters in pursuit of a goal. Was hoping it'd be more like before. And right now, our goal is to track down the guys who killed our boyfriend and shoved his brain into a sword.
Ooh, harsh. Oh, man, that's like a... Shoot, what is that game called? There was a Square Enix game that had mechs... And one of the titles of it had a plot point that was kind of like that. There is some weird crap going on.
Okay, the weird crap is the power of Zoner version 3. So one of our abilities is to stop time and plan out a turn. And when a Zoner version 3 is on the field, it will screw up our ability to see... while we are planning our turn.
Wait, so the visual crud it's putting in your way is actually supposed to get in your way, like, on purpose?
Yes, so
that's great.
If you are standing near the zoner, it makes it impossible to see everything that isn't near it. And if you are standing away from it, it makes it impossible to see exactly where it is.
That's excellent. Like, using visual crud to actively get in your way. I love it. Basically because video games do this anyway, and may as well make a mechanic out of it, right?
Yep.
Whoa, why are the corners all red? What was that about? That's usually a game's indicator that you're messing up.
Right, so above the four functions, there is sort of an empty bar. That is our health bar. It is currently at 1 point. I am almost dead right now. When you hit 1 point, or when... Now there's a bar recharging up top. That is my turn recharging. If my health is at 1 and my turn is recharging, the screen turns red. And if I take a hit when the screen turns red, I lose a function, just like I did right now.
Oh, man. Okay.
So I essentially have 4 lives. And when all of my functions are depleted, it is game over. And I go back to the last checkpoint.
So you also, like, you actually lose some capabilities while you get closer to death.
Yes.
Oh, neat.
And the game prioritizes the way that it takes things away, the order. First, it takes them away in order of how much it costs in terms of memory. So, for instance, if a function and all of the things that are upgrading it add up to 12, it'll take that away before it takes up the ones that add up to 11.
Okay.
And then also it prioritizes taking away your support functions over your offensive functions. So if you have something that deals damage and costs 4 and something that deals no damage and costs 1, it'll take away the thing that deals no damage even though it costs less.
Huh. Okay.
So always make sure that you can kill the enemies.
Yeah, I kind of hate to be asking basic questions, because I'm sure that you've explained all this by now to, like, everybody who's been watching the LP, but I've been purposefully not taking in any information about the game at all from any source since it was created for this purpose. So I guess what I'm saying is I'm sorry, but I'm not sorry.
I should have brought you in sooner. It's all right.
Oh,
now, fortunately, we have 2 instances of every function, so the one that I lost, I can just put right back on.
All right. So the mysterious smoky stranger voice who talks to you from now on again, that's the sword.
Yes, that is our boyfriend's brain in the sword.
I am seriously blanking on the name of that video game.
Xenogears?
I don't know, it was older than that. It was a Super Nintendo game.
Oh.
And one that didn't actually make it to the United States. I want to say it was like Metal Hazard or... Shoot. I'm gonna have to look this up. This is messing with me too bad. What's with the, like, snapshots of Muse over top of the screen? Is that one of Zoner's attacks?
Yeah, that is, I said Zoner's powers are disrupting your ability to see. That is its most basic thing, is it just plasters a snapshot of you over the top.
Oh, that's stylish. I like it. So, from time to time, the monsters seem to turn pink and then work for you.
Yes. I have upgraded function number 4, Cluster Bomb, with Charm. And so when I hit it, it switches it to my side for 3 seconds.
Just hold on.
Yes, 3 seconds.
Okay, the video game is called Front Mission. Congratulations to all of you at home who knew that immediately as soon as I said anything. You get a point. Points may be redeemed never for anything. You just have them.
So. I have trouble believing that that title is a plot point.
The title, no, but in Front Mission, one of the central things of the plot is that for the whole, like, game, you're, like, trying to save your girlfriend or whatever, you know, garbage masculinity thing. But when you finally find her, she's been turned into a brain in a jar that is also a mech computer. And even though all this brain is doing is processing, like, basic servo controls of the computer and all that, the main character still goes, "It's okay, honey, we'll be together now," and installs that computer in his mech for the rest of the game. And it is spooky as hell, and I love it.
I am going to go pilot my girlfriend.
Yeah. Whereas, I mean, in this case, the sword still talks to you and stuff, so that's... He's still at least an actor, if not a... we could call him a person, why not?
He's eggs. Also giving us powers.
Eggs.
Lots eggs. Eggs. Eggs will hatch into processes if not picked up.
Just any old process, or do they have one that they...
The one that they started as.
Oh, okay. Lobber.
Yep.
So, why don't you tell me a little bit more about the loadout that I've handed you here? What more particular challenges
just can't take a hand.
Does it present?
Okay.
Compared to like what you would ordinarily be doing.
So, our loadout to begin, number one is Snipe, which is a decently damaging laser that can pierce through obstacles and has a very long range but a sizable charge-up time. And onto that we've put Uppercut, which knocks processes into the air, and Sidearm, which decreases its planning cost in turn. The second one is Slam, which is the most basic hit-a-dude function.
Mm-hmm.
And it also will crash a process for about 3 seconds, which makes it take more damage from attacks.
Huh.
And equipped to that, we have Summon, which would create a dog in order to help us. But when equipped, it creates a 50... Yeah, that sounds right. 50% chance of a process not spawning any eggs when I kill it with that function.
Oh, neat.
Number three is... there's so many of these, I forget the names. Jumper.
Yeah.
Is Jumper. It jumps between enemies, decreases its damage total, and has a limited number of jumps. Equipped to it is Bomb, which as an upgrade increases its sort of area of effect, and Orb, which as an upgrade will have it leave a trail.
Hmm.
And then the last one is Cluster Bomb, upgraded with Charm and the second instance of Jumper.
All right, so that's the Charm is the pink thing, and that's why they work for us.
Yes. And then on the outsides of it, there are 4 slots, 2 of which are filled. Those are the passive slots, which always are doing something passively.
Sure.
The sort of circular, well, the purple one is Hide, which in this case, every time I kill a process, will speed me up and make me invisible for about 1.5 seconds.
Must have heard.
Oh, okay.
And
yeah, I saw that happen
one,
just that second.
The green one is Heal, which is actually doubling my health total right now. So I have 200 hit points instead of 100.
Man, you seem to have a lot of capabilities, just kind of a pile it on there.
Yeah, every single function does something distinct. They all have very good uses.
Hmm. Yeah, hence why you could like just give me a loadout, any loadout, I don't care, and then like make it work.
You asked me about challenges I get out of this one. There's one specific function that I'm almost never without. It's called Might. It's the red orb with a bunch of arrows pointing into it. It allows, when you use it on a function, it increases the damage it takes first to 125%, and then use it again, and it'll do 250%, and then use it again, and it does 375%.
Goodness.
And I am basically never without that in New Game Plus. And so,
until now! Yeah, I saw that on your bar a second ago. It looked like it had 4 pips. Like it was larger than the others.
It is an expensive function.
Mm. Oh, we have Pokemon in this game too, man.
Oh yes, the Haunters.
Yeah, apologies to like I guess page 2 or whatever, where people have definitely said that in your thread already.
My thread doesn't even have a page 2.
What? That doesn't make sense. We'll have to get on it. Post. Actually, don't. Don't post. it's bad.
So the Haunters are the last enemy type, and they have 4 different varieties as determined by the color of their hair.
Same for me, right?
We have the blue variety right now, the shooter. It basically just creates its haunts more often, and I think they do more damage. I'm not 100% sure on that one, though. The haunts are sort of the black clouds that will pop out and follow me around. The shooter varieties are the least dangerous out of the four.
I like the notion of a monster who is playing the cover-based shooter, like, against you. I've only gotten that out of Halo, and even then, kind of to a limited degree, the enemy AI is kind of bad.
Is anyone out there? I thought so.
Can other people hear the sword?
Yes, but there are no other people.
Yikes.
Whoa, harsh.
What, jeez. The population or the...
Yeah, just being the last human.
That was 50 of them back.
Well, okay, there are... Let's see. One, two, three, four besides Muse out there right now, for sure.
Oh. Okay, well...
There's a news reporter and three bad guys.
Time to dance. We dug in their heels this time.
We are actually going to the bad guy's cubicle right now, essentially. We're going to their place of business.
Man, why have to harsh up someone's cube?
Well, we need to go have a talk with them.
I mean, well, that's what the side rooms are for. We have plenty of meeting spaces. Straight down the hall. Look out. Okay, I'll go to the front desk. We'll check out a meeting space. I'm sure they have one available. It's been a little busy this week, so it might, you know, we might have to work a little bit. Be flexible with the time. Could be a good time spot. And have a nice sit down. We have, well, we don't have a whiteboard, but we do have the, like, large form poster board where you can just, like, rip a whole huge sheet off and then take it with you as your notes afterwards. Well, see that?
There is a chalkboard the size of four men in this man's cubicle.
Do you commonly measure your chalkboards in men? That's a four-man chalkboard.
It is an easily understood metric.
Yeah. The problem with that is, as soon as you say, like, this chalkboard is the size of four men, some stupid man's gonna say, "Not all men!" And you'll be like, "What are you even talking about, buddy?" Yes, it is not the size of four of all men. What does that even mean?
Get the entire male population of the Earth together at once and multiply them by four.
Yeah, then that's a very large chalkboard that we're talking about now. How does that fit in this man's cube? Is he rich?
He is probably the most politically powerful person in the city.
Oh, well, there you go. I guess he can have the biggest chalkboard that anyone gets. I'm laboring the point a little much, aren't I? I like the idea that things explode into eggs. So why do you sometimes collect, like, the egg, and then sometimes just leave them behind?
So, give it just a second. Those five little yellow squares that popped up on the lower right corner of the box, those are my limiters. Developers of this game, Supergiant, are very much in love with a modular difficulty system. They did it in Bastion, and they did it in this game, where you can equip different things to yourself that will cause the enemies to become more powerful in some way.
Right, I remember that from Bastion.
And in return, you get more experience points, or just a bigger challenge if you like that. And so I have a number of limiters equipped right now, one of which causes the process to spawn corrupted eggs.
Ooh.
And if you eat the corrupted egg, you take damage.
Don't eat the bad egg. Got it.
It's It's not a huge amount of damage. It will kill you if you're at very low health, but if you're at full health, you can pick it up and not worry.
So, talking about Bastion for a sec. For the longest time, I had the challenge god totem thing equipped that made enemies drop a little grenade when they died.
Yep.
I forgot I had turned that on and didn't know what they did. And so I thought for most of the game that this was just a feature. This just sort of happened with every single enemy. I'm like, man, this is a spiteful freaking game. Why do they all drop grenades? And then, finally I, read the thing again. And I'm like, oh, I am a moron. That's why they keep doing it.
At least Whoa. It wasn't the one that will randomly deflect your shots.
Yeah, Demolisher was wigging out there, ruining your encode.
Right.
Man.
The Demolishers are probably the second roughest process. Their 2.0 version has a retaliation mode where if you hit it, it will get very, very angry and just get up on top of you. It'll speed up and start dealing more damage.
That's crazy. Well, that was the 3.0 right there that you were fighting.
3.0 has a tractor beam. It will just...
All right, so that's what was happening.
Yes. And then all versions of it, every some amount of health, I've never been able to figure out how much, it'll get bigger, and that'll make it get faster and take less damage.
I do like enemies that get huge.
These guys get really, really huge.
Man, crazy. I love how there's a whole lot of visual stuff. There's a lot of screen effects and bright shinies and fireworks and all that. But I can still basically tell what's going on, and everything serves a purpose. I want to point at this.
What?
Be like, yo, okay, you're making video games? More of this, less of the Final Fantasies, right?
A lot of the visual effects get introduced over time. They're a effect of the process upgrading.
So
you have a learning curve.
And it's beautiful. It's like they made a video game or something. So this method, listen to me, I'm already talking like a computer scientist. But really, that's the word for it.
Look at how huge the Demolisher just got.
It's crazy.
Right. You were
just playing battle bots with each other. Is there some kind of arena in this game where you just throw one or two monsters in and then have them go at it?
Oh, I wish.
Because that would rule. Just be like, okay, we're gonna put these monsters in here. And you can, shoot from safety from the sidelines if you want to make things happen, but basically just watch them go. Be like playing noclip in Quake. What was I talking about?
You
graphics.
Something about
game.
Being a computer programmer.
Oh, right. I used the word method and got distracted. But no, where you have the real-time element and then a, freeze, plan-out, turn-based element? Harkens back to, just a whole legacy of American RPG from, the 1990s and early 2000s, where you have the whole, okay, there's a real time combo, and then you pause, and then command your characters to do a couple things. There are some games that I hesitate to mention, and indeed will not, that I did play and are horrid, but this seems to be pretty good about it.
It is never required to use the turn-based element. Whoa, hey. You can, with a correct loadout and sufficient skill, never have to stop time.
Man, you just crushed that guy.
Yeah,
jeez. Grapple me, will you?
I always want to overkill them because their defense just goes up. And so I never assume that the amount of damage that will be done to them is correct.
They put the fear in you. That's the problem. That's their true attack. The attack of fear.
Should be able to get him through here.
All right, now, right here, things are going to have to be changed up a bit because I lost Jumper in that last fight, and the second instance of Jumper is currently being equipped to Cluster Bomb. So I can't just re-equip it. I have to get to another checkpoint before I'll be able to get it back. So I am scrambling right here to try and come up with a new function number 3.
Leave it empty.
It can be a very bad idea.
Just put a blank one in there. It's there just for the hit point.
So in its place, I have Orb equipped with Bomb and Tracker.
Next up, High Rise.
So Supergiant Games seems to like their two-handed weapons. Like Bastion was basically designed around the sledgehammer, and in this one you have the freaking claymore for the entire thing.
Curiously enough, in this game, eventually we will find somebody who uses a no-handed weapon.
Wait, is that like weapons of diplomacy? Like the pen is mightier than the sword kind of thing? Like,
no.
I will use my words and not my hands.
No, it's more of a, I'm not going to touch my sword, it's just going to kind of float in front of me.
Close one. Makes a work day easier.
That was Orb, by the way. Just kind of vomiting orbs all over this elevator.
Welcome to High Rise. Welcome home. Good to be back here. Load up.
And now Jumper's back, so we're going to put it back in.
Okay. I was about to call shenanigans on you for changing away from the loadout that I'd required, but I guess if it's just for one elevator, that's fine.
Only if absolutely required.
Mm-hmm. Hey, grass or hawk. I frankly don't know what those cattails are.
They're gross. They make a popping noise when you step on them. I don't know if you saw it, but there is a dog on the field right now, and that dog is the worst thing in the game.
I think I've seen you go after the dogs before. Yeah. Flusher?
Flushers, because they are hunting dogs.
Sure. Flush out the prey. Why not?
Yes.
Why are they the worst?
All right, so first of all, they are the second fastest of all the functions, right after the speeders, which are named for their speed.
Okay. Be ashamed to have your thing named speeder and not the fastest.
Second, they have a frankly huge amount of health in comparison to everything else. I think they're at like 800 something, which is frankly enormous. So they are faster than Muse. They can always catch up to her, and they have a huge amount of health. Their attacks deal a significant amount of damage, and in their 3.0 variety, they will stun. And they have the ability to turn intangible completely without warning for several seconds.
That's my kind of monster. Where can I get one? I like dogs Let's well enough.
Best view they are town. Basically the worst.
It's strange coming here. Like this. Can't imagine what it's like for you.
Well, let me equip the imagining protocol.
Supremo Deluxe, loaded for bear. Flatbread delivery still going strong.
Not Is so this bad, supposed to be, like, charming? Because anymore. I'm just totally creeped out.
What, you don't like flatbread?
I can take Walk or leave it. Out. Here, it's How my talking doing? Sword. Telling me to eat in his presence.
It all looks fine
for Not weird. I don't know, you've spent more time with him than I have, so.
He's a very good, nice guy.
So the word is out. Can't even see the canals.
Oh, he's... It looks like he's not doing so hot, though.
Nope. No, our boyfriend is sick right now.
Might be time to cut him loose, I'm afraid.
Right, I'm sure we can bare hand this.
Wait, that's the end of the game, right? You dump him? Be like...
The
Sorry,
most...
hon, but you're not human.
The truth is the most opposite thing.
Oh no! We get a second boyfriend who's exactly like him.
That's not the direction
what
I thought.
What a terrible idea! What are you trying to teach me, video game?
Okay, so here's variety number two of the Haunters, the Cloakers. They can turn completely intangible, basically forever. You can't
what a charming
hit them.
Guy.
You can't hit them until they attack you. You have like a second and a half window to strike them while they're charging their attack.
Okay, so this happens from time to time. What's with the, like, Wujot eye that appears above Muse's head from time to time?
That would be when turn is recharging.
Ah, okay.
It's just another visual indicator in addition to the bar up top.
Yeah, all right.
One of the things about the Haunters is that they share their abilities with all other Haunters on the battlefield.
Oh, dang.
So if you have a intangible Haunter and a Haunter with powered up shots, then they are all intangible and all have powered up shots.
Nuts. That's pretty cool, though.
And there are two more varieties, and I'm pretty sure we're going to see them both.
So, is the little readout that you get popping out of enemies always there, or is that also something that you have to, like,
it
go
is
out
all,
of your way to do?
It is always there.
Okay, so you touch them, and then you get to learn about them.
Yes. Sometimes you just have to be within a certain distance of them.
Ah.
I'm doing everything in my power right now to keep the Flusher on my side. Because he will ruin me. Also, there's no friendly fire in this game, so if you switch a guy, you can't hit them.
Oh. It's kind of a Diablo 2 thing. Matter of fact, I'm certain that I've told this story in my own LP, but I'll load it out here too. Because it's just too great. So, in Diablo 2, there is a skill called Conversion. It's a paladin skill that if you hit a monster, it had a chance of, like, joining your side, and as you ranked the thing up, it would, like, last longer. So you'd have, like, this ally monster for a longer amount of time. The problem with that was any, like, party buffs that got applied also applied to it while it was converted. But when that wore off, it would still have the buffs because the buffs lasted longer.
Oh, dear.
And there are some things in that game that were not balanced around monster health. So, long story short, I was fighting a cow that had 90 times the amount of health that it should have. We just gave up. We left.
Never thought much of
Oh my.
Corrupted call. Cell. Oh, you ate the bad egg.
Yes.
You told me about that, but you ate it anyway.
Just makes things go faster sometimes.
Yeah. Just take the hit. There's an access point right there, that kind of thing.
Is in here? Besides me, I've seen no one. You can hear me, right?
I feel like now would be the time for Muse to pipe up and be like, yes, I can hear you, Jack,
or back from break.
Whatever his name is.
Alright, first of all, she lost her voice. I'm pretty sure it's a psychosomatic deal because she is still able to hum very easily. And second, we never find out Tiz's name.
Oh.
I kind of miss those.
If you dig through the game code, you can find a code name for him. But he has never actually given a name.
Alright, Jack it is. No, maybe Clay for Claymore. Yeah. I'm clever. I came up with a joke. I like Jack better, though. This game says egg a lot, and so I like it. It's egg. Egg.
I am currently breaking boxes that are filled with dozens of eggs.
Dozens of eggs. This is how omelets are made, people! I think you want to be nowhere near this town. Let's take a taxi out. For Demolisherville? No. Nope. No thanks.
Very start of the game, our boy said, alright, let's get out of town. We have a motorcycle, get on the freeway, just go, and do not turn left. What do you think she did?
Called a cab?
She turned left.
Oh, okay, fine. Is he like a neocon? Like, no, never to the left! That kind of thing. Like, in a couple instances in that fight, you were way too charming. Like, you hit them all with the charm, and then they just had their little dance sequence for a while.
Against guys like these, I always want to finish a turn with charm, just to make sure they are not trying to kill me while I cannot attack. I don't know if I mentioned that, but you can't actually attack while turn is recharging.
Did not gather that.
You know that, right?
Huh.
It's true.
There is
true.
A way Dragon to towers. Attack while turn is recharging. You have to equip a specific function to another function.
Alright. Can't just, like, give him a boot.
No, there is...
Like, you know, throw a couple elbows, maybe.
I would like it if I could just slap the sword and say, hurry it up.
Top of the town.
I would be just fine if this game had about 1,000% more elbow drops. But that's just me.
That'd be pretty old.
There's a whole lot of uppercuts, depending on how you play. And body checks.
Hey, there we go.
You can body check functions.
That's
or
right.
Processes.
Make sure the ref is not looking and keep your stick on the ice.
Would you look at the time? Is that what's doing this to me?
You look at the time. It's clobber o'clock.
Don't mind us.
Okay. Yes. Big scary dragon monster with a knife tail or something.
Back there.
Yes. It's that's what we're going to go kill right now.
Just the tail.
That was just the tip. I am impressed the game could avoid saying what I just said.
Jack has a little bit more class than you.
Don't let the spine have a
well, I'll just uninstall his class module. Strip that class right off. Yo!
See that spine? Excuse us. Pardon us.
Yeah, I'm with Jack. Let's get the hell out. Is there any spot where it seems to be like you go room to room fighting monsters, and it's like, okay, this room, this load out of monsters, this room, this load out of monsters, that kind of thing. Is there any way to avoid monsters? Can you just, like, run past them at any time?
Alright, so there are pitched fights, and there are free fights. Pitched fights are completely unavoidable. Next time we get into a fight, look around the edges of the screen and you might see a bunch of little turquoise dots pop up.
Right, the little fires that kind of like...
That is the arena. You cannot leave the arena until all foes are destroyed. Free fights happen in the last quarter of the game, and there are a whole bunch of processes just standing around destroying the town, and you can not bother them.
I'm with you, Jack. Nothing's worse than stairs. Stairs are hella dangerous. I keep trying to tell people, but don't believe me. Okay. I think they've overplayed the whole, like, monster tail thing at this point. It's kind of a Flash game conceit. I'm thinking specifically about Four Nights. No. Four Nights at Freddy? No, that's not it.
Five.
The Flash game where you're, like, a bunch of little knights and you hit guys a bunch.
Castle Crashers?
Castle Crashers, that's the one. That's exactly the kind of, like, set piece that would be in Castle Crashers. You just see, like, the Monty Python foot stomp on something, and then, like, at the end of the level, you fight a monster that's four times the height of the screen. And... Hey. Thanks for coming up with Castle Crashers for me. It would have taken me a while.
Hey, guess what we're gonna go do?
Please say immediately, because I don't think I can take any more tails popping out of the screen.
I have moderate news for you. We are close.
Almost.
I am frequently and also not frequently ready for moderate news.
Okay, so this elevator and then we're at the fight.
Gonna have to talk to the interior decorator around here. He missed a couple walls. Hell, maybe the architect.
What's the difference?
A little deeper.
Late in the game, we go to meet a civil engineer, and he's not all there in the head, so...
I need everything to be able to be seen from this angle.
God views things from an isometric perspective, so we need to be accommodating.
Is it possible to avoid those tail strikes, or
yes.
Is that...
It is entirely possible, but I know that there's an access point that will heal me at the top, and I know it won't kill me, so I just don't care.
Oh, okay. It's cute. A little cat scare. I like that.
Oh, dear.
All right, are you ready for a fight?
I can't.
Sort of.
So this is the monster that's been hitting us with its tail this whole time.
Jerk.
That gray blob behind it is its body. This thing is massive.
That's pretty huge.
Yeah.
Oh no, eggs.
Yes. It vomits eggs when you hit it for enough health. Every 1,000 health, I think. It has 4,000 health. The laser that it shoots out of its eye is not hyper-damaging, but it shoots it a ton of times, and it knocks you around just enough that it can basically stunlock you. And also, it's still hitting us with its tail.
What a charmer. So you get to play Space Invaders with it a little, huh? I mean, with the walls between you and it.
Yes. The walls are extremely crucial to not get annihilated.
Man, respawning walls. They didn't introduce that until Space Invaders 3. Look it up. Oh, that's cute. You leave little shadows behind whenever you do a move. Like, that's your plan.
Yeah.
All right, I'm seeing the stun lock feature there.
Yes.
Kind of nasty.
It's not helped by the speeders. They their shots will slow you down for several seconds. Just to an absolute snail's pace. You can prevent that from happening if you put slam into a passive slot.
Huh. Man, almost there. Just gotta crush this guy. Oh. Maybe it's worse than that. So, what would your ideal loadout for this guy be like?
I've actually killed this guy in 2 turns.
Goodness.
Yes. It's all about buff and debuff stacking.
Huh.
I would use Might, upgraded with Slam and Tracker. I would use Hide, upgraded with Hide, which, after you use it, will double the damage of the next attack you do. And then I would use Hook, which deals more damage the farther away you are from a target, and upgrade that with Snipe in order to increase its range. And with that, I just kill it in 2 shots.
It's kind of gruesome that you went inside the thing and hit it in the heart that it told you how many beats per minute.
It told us that the texture was greasy.
For whatever you did back there. Among other things.
So we broke the spine and tore out its heart.
Well, he had it coming. He had that precise thing. He read a fortune cookie this morning that said that on it. Muse is going to come and chop your head off and tear out your heart.
You're going to have a bad day today.
It was a very dire fortune cookie.
So that's it.
Wow. Exciting. I'm glad I managed to rob you of one of the things you never take off.
So how do you like it?
It looks good. Looks like a lot of fun. I think the customization would make a lot more sense if I knew the game. But I don't.